In this video, I'll be predicting the Eastern Conference Finals. Comparing these teams and trying to proclaim superiority was a damn tough challenge for me, as both Miami and Boston have the go-to options that can hit shots in the most pressured moments. I'll show you the storylines heading into this series, what bodes well for both teams, and who will advance to the title. Quickly, two shoutouts since we skipped community speech last video to Kardik for saying his favorite part of the Mitchell-Murray duel was the record-setting three-pointers made from the two, and to Omarinator, who says Luka is the biggest boomer bust player there is. The question for next video shoutout and to compete for yearly awards is coming up. The Boston-Miami rivalry is about to write another monumental chapter. Boston's trying to get back to the finals for the first time since 2008, and Miami's in its first conference finals appearance since the LeBron era. The 2020 East Finals in the NBA bubble is a complete toss-up. A dominant trio of Tatum, Brown, and Walker will battle against the top two-way player in the NBA, the man who just embarrassed Giannis and Jimmy Butler, who's surrounded by a cast perfectly suited to go the distance. Fueled by 43 points from their superstar Jimmy G Buckets and his all-star running mate the Dragon Goran Dragic, the Heat are 8-1 in the postseason. Additionally, dominant contributions up front from Bam Adebayo opens up space for shooters like rookie Tyler Herro and sophomore Duncan Robinson. Really impressed from what I'm seeing from Bam up front. He's one of the best centers in basketball. But even though the shooters lack experience, both Herro and Robinson have proved they can step up to the moment. The two young Miami Heat snipers have both shot around 40% from three-point range, which is elite efficiency, and either one is capable of going off for monster games on any given night. And those performances could very well swing a series. Given Miami's taken care of business, they'll be fully rested going up against the Celtics. You also have to take into account that at the same time Boston was grinding through a 7-game battle with the reigning champs, the Heat were lounging in the bubble. I know the Celtics are a young team, but that was a hard-fought, physically draining duel. So in the later stages of the conference finals, I think you could see the Celtics show some signs of wear and tear. However, two of Boston's top three stars are under the age of 24, so I'm not too worried about that. The concern in question for Miami is, will a week of time off disrupt the lethal rhythm that they had, or will the rest be beneficial? Sure, experienced veterans Iguodala, Crowder, plus Dragic and Butler will value having fresh legs, but for players like Adebayo, Robinson, and Herro, I question how all this time off will affect them mentally. Bam, Duncan, and Tyler make up 3 of 6 Miami Heat players, averaging at least 10 points per game in these playoffs, so their youth has certainly proved themselves through 2 rounds, highly contributing to their overpowering sweep of a scrappy Pacer squad and a shocking 5-game series win over Giannis's Bucks. But there's no doubt Jimmy Butler's desire to finally get out of his conference will ultimately drive the Heat's chances in this series, more on that coming up. However, Miami's about to meet a whole different animal in the fierce and overwhelmingly talented Boston Celtics. There isn't a team remaining whose top three scorers are as reliable as Boston's, stopping multi-dimensional offensive creators Jaylen Brown, Jason Tatum, and Kemba Walker simultaneously requires tactical game planning and is fairly impossible. Toronto put a box and one on Kemba Walker, and to avoid having smaller defenders switch onto Tatum and Brown, they started the possession with having Lowry and Van Vliet on those two, which allowed their lengthier stoppers Siakam and Ananobi to switch onto them. Heat coach Eric Spoelstra will certainly have to make better player substitutions than Nick Nurse, but whether or not Eric can game plan defensively for Boston's trio better than Toronto will be crucial. Before I give you my prediction for who's going to win this series and how many games, I'm going to tell you what bodes well for both teams in this matchup. First, for the Celtics, and Jaylen Brown wasn't named a 2020 All-Star, but it's still easy to say that Boston has 3 All-Star caliber talents in Kemba and their 2 dominant young wings, Tatum and Brown. They have 3 players who they can rely on in pressured moments to create a ton of space off the dribble, then either pull up for timely deep-range bombs or relentlessly attack the paint. Rising phenom Jason Tatum took out my Raptors and is developing into a superstar right before our eyes. In Game 7 of the conference semis, Jason Tatum became the 2nd youngest player behind only Kobe to record 25-plus points, 10-plus rebounds, and 5-plus assists in a Game 7. When the 22-year-old is creating space, knocking down bombs, and is in his typical J-smooth rhythm, that provides a ton of energy and confidence to the Celtics' main role players. The supporting cast revolves around an all-NBA first-team defender in Marcus Smart, a lockdown perimeter center in Daniel Theis, and the EuroLeague champion playmaking sharpshooter Brad Wanamaker. You can't forget about backup center Robert Williams III, who in pick and rolls can catch and explode over defenders. The prospect Williams should see some time trying to stop Bam Adebayo, and whoever's more physical between those two could take their team a long way. At shooting guard, Marcus Smart's efficiency spacing the floor for his all-star teammates is going to be a crucial factor. I didn't expect Smart to put up 15-plus points in four games of the conference semis. The lockdown defender should see a good amount of time pestering Jimmy Butler. Those should be some heated interactions and entertaining ones. Boding well for Miami, though, their top guy in Jimmy Butler doesn't fold when his team needs something from him. He's a bona fide superstar and is extremely clutch. Butler's gone through a lot in his lengthy postseason career, with three series losses to LeBron, one to John Wall, another to Kawhi, and even a loss in 2017 to Isaiah Thomas and the Celtics. 2020's postseason is showing how much Butler has learned from those experiences in terms of how he's coming through when his team needs buckets the most. In the last 5 minutes of 2020 playoff games, aka clutch scoring, Jimmy's tied with Kawhi Leonard to have the second most points of any player. Whether it's ripping his opponent and generally locking up defensively, or creating and dropping in buckets from anywhere at any time, the Heat superstar is making utterly elite plays on both ends of the floor. The Heat have grizzled veterans on the wing to either knock down perimeter jumpers or bother attackers. There's the champion Andre Iguodala and the reputable two-way wing defender Jay Crowder. Those two small forwards plus Jimmy Butler I expect to see guarding Tatum and Brown, but I also expect Spoelstra to use a mix of every single one of his wing players to try and stop the Celtics' two young phenoms. Iggy, Crowder, Robinson, Harrow, Jones Jr., and Butler are collectively bigger, more physically imposing defenders than what Boston saw in the last series. It'll be a different, tougher challenge for the Celtic wings. As you can see, the two teams remaining in the Eastern Conference 1 through 10 in the depth chart are no joke, and are not only built for the finals, but to achieve championship glory. But while I've broken down the impact of the role players and matchup advantages defensively, ultimately the outcome of this series will be based off which team's main options knock down the tough under-pressure shots. So, will we see Jason Tatum solidify himself as a top 5 player in this league, or will it be a consistent display of strength, acrobatics, and shot creating from Jimmy Butler like it was to embarrass the team with the best record in the NBA? Butler's hungry to reach his first finals ever, and he's not going to let two players in their young 20s make every crucial play like they executed in their battle with Toronto, because unlike some number one options,
come on, man, you're making money.
Jimmy Butler makes you pay every time you leave him open. The Celtics beat the team I cheer for in the Raptors, so you may say I have a bias here. I just think Boston was let off the hook, specifically down the stretch of Game 7. Toronto made some big-time mistakes. Given Miami's stock of experienced veterans who are tremendous leaders, they hold everyone accountable, so the Heat's young players aren't going to make the mistakes that Toronto's youth ultimately cost them with. Guys like Dragic, Iguodala, and the leader at the top, Jimmy Butler, keep everyone in check. The Celtics have a fiery young combo that's on its way at some point to a championship, which Celtics fans are craving, but while Boston has the flashy young talent, Miami's well-rounded firepower inside and out, combined with their leadership and experience, will push them over the top. Boston can, and I think will, learn from this and get a ring potentially in a year or two, but it won't be this year, as I'm predicting they'll come up short in 6 games against the Miami Heat. But for next video shoutout, give me your reasoning for who you think wins this series. If you haven't already and enjoyed the content, I'd appreciate it if you hit subscribe and left a like on the video so more people see it. It'd be greatly appreciated. This was D-Flow. Keep watching some of my recent uploads. Have a great one, and I'll see you next video.